Please welcome our first speaker to the stage, Thomas Gooder. This is working. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Thomas. A few years ago, we went into this crazy story about a startup in the with a vision to replace pen and paper. I'm not going to talk too much about us, nor am I going to talk about what we do and show the features and so on. However, I'm going to build up on what we just saw and actually use that as a concrete, we have a concrete example, 1.5 billion, so just above the average project that I'm going to use to prove some of the things that have been said. But one of the important aspects that was alluded a few times is, while we all talk about digitization, the third bucket, there's one thing that companies, construction companies, absolutely need to do is actually start standardizing even before using technology. Otherwise, afterwards, they just throw these tablets or whatever technology they have, BIM and so on, through the window. So I'm going to use a lot of what has been said in the previous slides. Productivity didn't go up. Actually, it went down. The way we summarize it, again, some of it came back, is the same way. Basically, the projects take on average 20% longer to finish, and usually 80% of these projects are over budget. Second, productivity, like I said, is going down. Regulations is actually increasing, and not only regulations coming from government, but also one thing that a lot of people are forgetting is ISO 9001, 14000, 18000 is hitting these companies much more than it used to. 5 years ago, you had two or three of these bigger bits that were ISO requirements. Nowadays, it's 6 or 7 out of 10. So these things, even though it's not really regulations, it's requirements that they need to do. It's a lot of admin that comes on top of it. R&D, I think it's been said. The one I'm going to focus on mostly is the projects take 20% longer, and on average, 80% of them are over budget. So, to give you, for the ones who are not very familiar with the construction sector, a little bit of an insight, it has very unique characteristics. Very fragmented, a lot of small players. There are no global players worldwide. Very few of them, let's put it this way. You have a few of them in France that are also worldwide, but apart from that, there's no one big player worldwide, which is very different to most of the other industries. There are on-site projects. Again, it's something that a lot of people don't realize. That's where 80% of the work is done. And from a project definition, again, it's been discussed, but there's very immature project definitions. What I mean by that is a lot depends on which is the team on site. If you have a good project manager, they come in with a lot of checklists, they go on site, and they know how to do their stuff. You have a bad project manager, it's completely chaotic. And so there are a number of these aspects. I mean, we can go, but we only have 8 minutes. But these are things that you can find in some of these very interesting papers that exist out there. One of the ones that we want to change is actually the challenge of the cost of change. Basically, what this is, your ability to change things reduces over time, and the cost is going up. So what it means, a lot of tools like us were used usually at the end of a project to document all the defects and so on. What we see is more and more trends of bring us more and more at the beginning of the project so we can document them. This is a slide you probably edited. So what are tools like us, more in collaboration, need to have? Basically, they need to be compatible. We are just more fitting in a best-of-breed strategy than a big tool that does it all. Second, it needs to be portable. Of course, it's on-site. And thirdly, it's user-friendly. Then there are a number of features or functionality it needs to have. It doesn't mean that the tool needs to do everything, but it needs to be able to interact. And why do I say interact? Because yes, the end goal is actually to talk to the design and master planning. But on site, that never happens. They only see a 3 to 6 week planning. They don't see the global picture, but they need to communicate very intensively between what's happening on site and bringing it back to the office. So I'm going to use the use case of the schools of tomorrow in School of Armoin in Flemish. basically, what was the scope? It's to this date one of the biggest social infrastructure projects in Europe. It's 182 schools, it is 710,000 square meters, and 1.5 billion euros. And the project were between 500,000 euros and 55 million. So it's pretty wide, and a lot of the contractors will fit into that in their average projects, because even the bigger contractors across the globe, they have, yes, these big 1 billion projects, but they earn a lot of money on their smaller projects. I mean, that's one thing that's important. It was a PPP or DBM, so that's why I asked the question earlier on. And they had, and that's an important part, AGE had the 30 years maintenance, which forced them to produce quality products, like they call it. Participants, 13 joint ventures, represented the 30 biggest contractors of Belgium, 60 architects, 30 engineers, controlling firms, AGE, of course, the school representative, and the Flemish government. What were the challenges? Yeah, they had a high volume of projects, significant penalties in the contracts, and they were responsible for the maintenance. What were their needs? They wanted to create transparency because they wanted to mitigate risks. What they also wanted, accountability on different stakeholders. What they did very well is actually they had a central team. They defined their processes, selected tools that were very well integrated or integratable, because we didn't have a lot of these integrations when we came in. Overall, they delivered 150 projects over 30 months. So it was a pretty fast pace. These projects were across Belgium, which is not the biggest country in Europe, but still. And what you can also see is there was a planning done in 2012, and there was only 9 months delay in total, everything included, permits and so on, 5 years later. Which for such a program is pretty impressive. Most of them go way beyond, way further than that. The other aspect, and that's one where we contributed quite a bit, I said earlier on 20% delay. Well, here, 93% were on time. And actually, if you take within the 60 days, 98% were within the agreed timing. That's one of the major things that they were able to do over roughly 3 years. The second aspect, budget. I said 80% were over the budget. Well, here, 16 of them, 16%, where 10% were less than 5% overrun, 4% between 4 and 10, and 2 only above 10%. So again, here, that's where the PPP came in. It's okay, it's maybe not the most beneficial for us as buyers, but what it pushed them to do is to take significant risk in technology and process and so on, and they were very agile about this. So this presentation I didn't do myself. We present this in Belgium now at a few contractors and so on, because they want to push the industry into that direction. So AGE is actually really pushing on all of their other projects to do the same. What they did is they defined some processes, but starts very small. They didn't do the big bang from the beginning. They start small. They had constant monitoring. They used multiple tools, and Klaus and Ulrich, I'm sorry, they were still in. But they had a document management system. They were very transparent in their reporting, meaning when things went good and well, they had very good internal communication, but also external communication about it. So very transparent about it. I put ourselves in the middle. It was a little bit the case, but the purpose is we were integrated with some other tools, bidirectionally, so that they could report on a lot of these dimensions, on all of these aspects. Basically, what they focused was user adoption, digital data, and standardization. That's what they really focused on, and the benefits were pretty good. I'm going to show you that because I only have 2 minutes left. What you see here is actually the conclusions of what they did after 150 projects. Basically here, you see the volume of square meters delivered. And here you see the number of snags, if you want, during the handover. So even though the volume increased, the snags went down. What they also brought is a lot of transparency of who were the good and the bad performers. And even though they were able to measure all their contractors on the same basis, on the same scale, across the 150 projects. And lastly, they also monitored what was the cost of the standardization when it comes to training. The two conclusions you can get from is basically in the beginning was pretty intense. It costed quite a bit. We paid for it. But at the end, it went significantly down. But what you can also see is it never goes to zero. So standardization, digitization, it's continuous and you need to reinforce it. And you will be surprised, but a lot of the people on site, they want it. They want this process as defined. They want clarity. They're sick of going from one project to another and starting over again, defining new processes. And so these are just two of the things. The main advantages you have is it was easy for them to switch from one project to another. The second, they were very quick at seeing where there was a mistake and they could solve it very easily. So the conclusions, well, basically, both in the technology they were using, but also in the processes they were defining, user adoption was key. They integrated data so that they had one big view of everything. They standardized but started small, and they continued to train their people. That's it for me.